Because Daniel just disabled core mechanics of the game multiple times, like with just a single card. It's just nuts, like utterly fucking broken. That can stop my opponent from using monster effects, using spell cards, or using trap cards. Depending on the type of deck that you're going up against, I mean, it basically can just spell their demise. And it was so easy to summon, especially when we got pendulum summoning. I mean, there was just so many crazy things that Shockmaster was able to do. This card is so unmade because the amount of just oppression this card inflicts just by hitting the board is just insane. It's utterly ridiculous. Honestly,
it's what I was looking to do.
Monster ever printed. That's why I had to put it on this list. But moving on to number 18, we go from the most powerful Xyz monster to the most powerful fusion monster ever printed.
Norden.
Oh, it's Elder Entity Norden. Fuck, it's no introduction. This card, as soon as it was released, luckily it ends. I mean, could you imagine if this card were in a core set? Norden is just a beast. I mean, being able to take advantage of a card like Instant Fusion and Special Summon Norden, which didn't get you back any other card, which basically gave you an automatic rank 4 play. Back in the day, this was just nuts. This card was so abusable, especially back during the Zodiac Fusion Substitute days, where you were able to just make Norden just like crazy. You were able to plus so hard before your opponent even managed to get a turn. A lot of people are really happy that Norden's banned. I'm happy that Norden's banned. This card is just way too powerful. Honestly, again, another card that probably should have never been made, but I guess for the time it did have it, it was a lot of fun, but I think a lot of us are glad that its time has come and gone. Now, for number 17, we have a card that pretty much changed our whole perspective on deck building altogether, and it's that grass looks greener. Yeah, remember that whole saying that 60 is the new 40? Well, grass is the sole reason for that phrase's existence. I mean, if you're playing a 60-card deck, going up against an opponent with a 40-card deck, they basically had three automatic win cards that they were playing in that 60-card deck. And if they happened to resolve, guess what? The deck with 40 cards pretty much had absolutely no chance. There were so many cool strategies that came from the 60-card era. I mean, there was like 60-card Paleozoic, 60-card Lightsworn. There were so many different variants. What I liked about it is that it actually made decks that may not have been relevant, more relevant, because of you had this card that was so powerful and basically just automatically won you the game, maybe strategies like Lightsworn actually viable, and we saw that for a very short period of time. And that doesn't kind of change how we look at deck building altogether, and you even see nowadays, players are not always going for the straight 40 or 41 cards. We see 50 card decks, we see 60 card decks that don't play grass, and yeah, it's still legal in the OCG, but I think it's really cool that a single card could do this, pretty much had a lasting impression on the game forever, and that's why I put it at number 17. Now for number 16, we got one of the most broken-as-fuck spell cards from the old days of Yu-Gi-Oh, and if you played back in the day, you're gonna know exactly where I'm going with this, Dimension Fusion. We already talked about how powerful and broken Return from a Different Dimension was. Well, what if Return from a Different Dimension was a spell card? Yeah, that's basically Dimension Fusion. Now, being a spell card not only allowed you to play it during your own turn and not having to wait a turn for the setup, but you're also able to abuse it with a myriad of different cards. I mean, Dark Magician of Chaos was able to abuse it, Magician of Fate was able to grab it back from the graveyard, Diamond Dude was able to send it, and you were able to activate it without paying cost. Dimension Fusion was insane. And again, we already talked about cards that summon just an absurd amount of resources, especially out of the banished pile. Think how easy it is to get cards banished that you could easily recur and possibly just go off in some insane link plays. Yeah, Dimension Fusion banned, it was so powerful, especially in the Chaos days, that I don't even want to think about how crazy and degenerate this card would be in today's game. Now, for number 15, we have, again, one of the oldest cards ever printed in this game, Change of Heart. Change of Heart danger, because back in the day, being able to steal your opponent's resources was crazy, and Change of Heart has no cost. It's a normal spell card. It's one of the hardest things to stop. Even to this day, normal spell cards are very annoying to deal with, and changing possession of the ownership of a monster is crazy. It doesn't care about position, so back in the day, when there were split monsters, you can get the value of some morphing jar or anything that your opponent may have in the graveyard. If it was a Magician of Fate, you flip it up, get that back. That didn't seem overpowered, right? It wasn't once per turn. I mean, this is just, you know, a classic example of a rate, especially by 2018 standards. So, yeah, we still play stuff like Mind Control. Imagine Mind Control with zero restrictions. Yeah, Change of Heart is so powerful and definitely deserves this list. Now, that brings us on to number 14. For number 14, we have another card from the good old days, and that is Confiscation. Confiscation was, in my opinion, the best out of all of the hand disruption spell cards from the old days because, very similar to something like Forceful Sentry, having the information of what's in your opponent's hand is invaluable because then you not only get to rip a card from their hand, but you also get to see everything else they have so you know everything to play around. Especially now that we have hand traps, this is so crucial because you can basically make an entire play knowing what your opponent has, and you can basically just soft lock them out of being able to play and just play around everything that they may possibly have, putting you in the most advantageous position possible. Now, the starting card in their hand may not always be the best depending on the type of deck they're playing, but why I like Confiscation over the Forceful Sentry is most of the time you're going to want to hit their power cards. I mean, if you hit something like Tour Guide and Burning Abyss, they only have one Tour Guide that's limited to one, and there's no way they're going to be getting that card back. Same thing goes for any of the power spell or trap cards. I mean, something like Soul Charge or, you know, just anything that you never want to see them get back, Confiscation is going to basically remove it from the game, and I find that slightly better than the Forceful Sentry because they have the chance to draw it again because it's going to shuffle back into their deck. You never really know. I'd rather just remove that variance from the card entirely. Call one of the craziest legacies in this game. I think a lot of people are glad that it's banned, but definitely one of the most powerful cards ever created. But for number 13, we have one of the most powerful draw spells ever printed. Pot of Greed. Pot of Greed has to be high on this list because it's just so simple. Draw two cards. There's no drawback. There's no downside. You can use multiple in a turn. Like, how could it get any better than this? And yeah, it's only a plus one in terms of card advantage, but if this card were legal, every single deck would be playing. There's no better feeling than playing back in the day when you have no cards in hand, no cards on your top deck of Pot of Greed. I don't know poetic about Pot of Greed. It's one of the notorious and just popular cards to ever be printed. Everyone knows Pot of Greed. Everyone knows Yu-Gi-Oh! Just like Dark Magician and Blue Eyes White Dragon, they probably know what Pot of Greed is, and I think that's just pretty much a testament to how incredible this card is. Now, for number 12, we have...
Why don't more people on SSI and SSD know about the Social Security $1,000 debit cards?
How incredible this card is. Now, for number 12, we have not one, but games history, and that is no understatement, the Dragon Rulers. I wanted to put all four of the Dragon Rulers together. The Dragon Rulers changed the game. There were really cards that had, like, three effects on them. And not to mention, they didn't just have three effects. They had three of probably the most broken effects you could have ever imagined. I mean, Yu-Gi-Oh was accelerating to the pace that was already getting out of hand, but the Dragon Rulers just took it to an entirely different level. Not to mention, back in the day, you had stuff like Draco Sack, you had Big Eye. I mean, there was just so much power behind each and every one of these cards. You know, I just can't believe that these cards left such a legacy and are pretty much revered as one of the strongest, if not the strongest deck of all time, which obviously is debatable, but, I mean, everyone who's played competitive Yu-Gi-Oh knows about the Dragon Rulers. They fear the Dragon Rulers ever coming off the ban list. Tempest just came off in the OCG, so I guess we're slowly starting to get to that point where maybe it's enough, but even outside their own archetype, they can be splashed in other decks, and I think that's just something that's so incredibly cool about them in general, just all upside, all powerful, man, definitely deserving of this number 12 slot. But to wrap up this video, at number 11, we have one of the most insanely powerful and degenerate trap cards ever in this game, Vanity's Emptiness. Vanity's Emptiness, you guys knew this was coming on here somewhere. And I had to put Vanity's emptiness up here because this card literally just locks so many decks out from being able to play the game. There's so many degenerate ways to pretty much protect even with its inherent drawback, which you think wouldn't be too difficult to work around because you just have to destroy any card for Vanity's to be destroyed as well. But there's so many instances where players wouldn't even get the opportunity to play just because of the fact that they couldn't special summon. Yu-Gi-Oh! Is so highly dependent on the special summon that this card literally warped formats. I mean, there's so many instances where this card just wreaked havoc and has such a legacy in this game. People are still traumatized to this very day from Vanity's emptiness. I know I am, but man, one of the most powerful cards ever created. I think it might be one of the most expensive cards ever printed at the common rarity because they were going for like $30 or $40 back when it was a short print in Star Strike Blast. But man, what a legacy. Vanity's emptiness had to take the number slot and had to wrap up this video, but we still have 10 more cards to go. So if you guys thought these cards were crazy, it's only gonna get crazier. So I hope you guys stick around. Thank you so much for watching the video. Be sure to like the video as always. Subscribe to the channel for more amazing Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. If you found this video entertaining, consider supporting me on Patreon or becoming a YouTube channel member. Because just by showing your support in any way that you can, you're investing in my ability to continue bringing you amazing Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. So thanks so much again, and we'll see you next time.
Let's finish it up.
Are you guys ready? Guys, it's Simon. Welcome to the final episode of the top 100 Yu-Gi-Oh! Cards of all time. From Dark Arm Dragon to Dimension Fusion, all the way to the Dragon Rulers, we have gone all the way across the spectrum of Yu-Gi-Oh!'s history. We've covered some of the craziest, most insane cards ever created, and we still have 10 more to go. So if you didn't see the last video, I'll have the link on the screen or down in the description. And before we get into it, big shout-outs to all of my patrons and my YouTube channel members for their continued support. And if you guys really want to help support the channel, hit the join button down below or check out the links in the description. But without further ado, let's go ahead and bust out the last top 10. Starting, of course, with number 10, we have a card that is so powerful that we don't even actually have it legal yet here in the TCG, but I felt it actually had to make the list because this card actually just warped deck building forever, especially for the
This card actually just warped deck building forever,
especially for the LCG players, even though we have yet to experience it here in the TCG. And that card is Crystron Needlefiber. Now, I know you guys are thinking this might be a little bit, you know, overboard having a card on this list this high that we have yet to even see here in the TCG. Crystron Needlefiber is that fucking broken. This card literally changes how the entire game is played. You're gonna want to just have so many random tuner monsters in your deck just to be able to support being able to link summon Crystron Needlefiber. It's that powerful of a card. This card has so much upside, basically enables so much degenerate bullshit that I had to put it in the top 10. If you literally look at decklists in the OCG, they're pretty much all playing Crystron Needlefiber. Ever since this card came out, it has made its presence known because it is incredibly powerful. Not even the fact that you have the ability and the synergy with all the different tuner monsters to be able to do all these different crazy things, but then you also have its tag out ability as well to go into something like Wonder Magician, which then goes into all these other shenanigans. Like, the card is just absurd. Like, I am actually so grateful we do not yet have this card in the TCG at the time of recording this video. I'm honestly okay if we never get it because this card is just so crazy, so powerful. I kind of want to break Yu-Gi-Oh! Even more than it already is. But that brings us on to number 9. Now, for number 9, we have a card that we didn't get here in the TCG way later than when it was initially released in the OCG, but yet pretty much should have never come here in the first place, or should have just been immediately banned at the time. Sixth Sense. And rather than talking about Sixth Sense myself, I'm gonna go ahead and let Lithium 2300 take it from here.
Thank you, Seal. Sixth Sense, one of the best trap cards ever in this game. It was released quite early in the OCG play September 2003 with two other promos in a small set called the Valuable Book 6. Back then, players were allowed to play three copies in their main deck. The early years of Yu-Gi-Oh! Were the Chaos years. As you know, good old Chaos formats were flip effects, and getting a potential plus one over your opponent could be game changing. Now, if you look at Sixth Sense with one dice roll, it could easily give you 5 or 6 extra draws. In most situations, you want to call 5 or 6, giving you a 1 out of 3 chance to draw the same amount of cards. If not, that's fine, you still get the mill cards, and of course maybe fueling your Chaos boss monsters. Early as of 2005, Sixth Sense eventually got banned in the OCG. In 2013, during the Marrow Ball, Dragon Rulers performance, and the TCG finally getting access to Sixth Sense, the card was a huge success in Dragon Rulers, potentially giving you 3 to 4 draws, or 5 or 6 cards milled, or tough luck if your opponent rolled a 1 or 2. Sixth Sense immediately was limited when released, but it didn't take Konami TCG long to eventually ban it also. Okay, thank you, Simo. Now back to you.
Now moving on to number 8, we have definitively, without a doubt, the strongest hand trap ever printed in this game's history, Maxi. Maxi just creates the dynamic between two players in a game that no other card does. I mean, the fact that your opponent can drop it on you at any moment, basically putting you in a situation where if you want to continue special summoning, you have to give your opponent resources. And with card advantage being so important in Yu-Gi-Oh!, especially more so than in any other card game, every single card you give to your opponent is basically a card that you can probably just win with on the next turn if you don't kill them. This is basically known as the Maxi challenge, where you either win that turn or you're going to lose because your opponent is just going to kill you with a handful of 20 cards. Maxi, while it may sound like it's a good concept in theory because it kind of limits and prohibits pretty much all the players from wanting to go off or go all in, it also just creates this environment where the player who has Maxi has all of the power. And if the opposing player also doesn't have Maxi but you do, then you're probably just going to win because your opponent's going to stop short of having anything, any strong board whatsoever, really. Then you can just stop them with Maxi and then go in with your own board. And also, if they don't have their own Maxi, you probably just won. But you didn't really win because of your deck, you won because you had Maxi. Now, again, this is a very polarizing opinion because Maxi is a 3 in the OCG and people are kind of okay with it there, but there's also plenty of disdain for the card over there as well. I'm on the fence that the card should never be unbanned, even though Yu-Gi-Oh! Is in a crazy state that it is, because it's not really gonna fix anything. It's just kind of gonna make people even more upset that they didn't draw Maxi when their opponent did. Now, for number 7, we probably have the strongest trap card ever printed in this game's history, Royal Oppression. And rather than talk about Royal Oppression myself, I'm gonna go ahead and hand it over to House of Champs so he can share with you this card's legacy.
Why, it's good Simo fans, and welcome to one of the most insane cards in all of history. You guys thought Vanity's emptiness was bad. Well, you might not have played in an era where this existed. Royal Oppression is basically an emptiness that you turn on, especially being ahead in the game, that just says, nah, we're gonna stop the special summoning throughout this duel. Either player can pay 800 life points to negate the special summon of a monster or monsters, and/or an effect that special summons a monster or monsters, and destroy those cards. You might have heard, actually, one of Robbie Cole's namesakes, oppression gadgets being a thing back in the day. Definitely royal oppression just gave power and credence to decks that had slower strategies and would also just shut down the bigger decks. Highly, highly, insanely toxic for the game, and I am glad it remains on the forbidden and limited list today, where it should stay forever. I don't care what Arata you want to give this. Just make something new and leave this out of the Yu-Gi-Oh! I want to play. Thank you.
Now, moving on to number 6. Oh boy, if you guys thought we were done with pendulum monsters, then you are dead wrong, because there is one pendulum monster we've still not talked about, and honestly, it's probably the single best pendulum monster ever printed in this game's history, Performa Pal Monkey Board. Man, if you guys think back to the days of Pepe, when Pepe was arguably going to be the next tier 0 deck, I honestly think Pepe is the strongest deck of all time, even though it was very short-lived for us here in the TCG. Monkey Board is pretty much the reason for this deck's power. I mean, you have a single pendulum card that essentially acts as two pendulum scales, because as soon as Monkey Board is activated, oh, guess what? You need to just get another scale for